What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. REST APIs, controllers, database migrations, architecture, security, and many more topics surrounding Spring Boot were tackled throughout this series. However, the concepts at the heart of this framework have not been covered, and that's what we'll attempt to do in this video. Therefore, let's start by understanding one of the main design principles behind the Spring framework, which is inversion of control. This principle states that a software component or application is designed to receive its dependencies from an external source, framework, or container, rather than creating them itself. This is in contrast to traditional software design, where an application is responsible for creating and managing its own dependencies. Now, in Spring Boot's case, inversion of control is implemented using dependency injection with the help of a Spring container. So, instead of directly creating dependencies within a class, dependencies are provided from an external source, the Spring container. Let's break this sentence down. You see, inversion of control and dependency injection are often used synonymously, but it's essential to recognize the subtle difference between them. Inversion of control refers to the principle of handing over the control of our application's components to an external entity. It basically suggests that we shouldn't create or manage our components ourselves, instead hand this task over to someone else. Whereas dependency injection is a specific implementation of IoC that focuses on managing the dependencies required by these components, which in turn are components themselves within the system. Spring Boot achieves IoC through its inversion of control container, also known as the Spring container, which manages the lifecycle of our components. This container is represented by the application context interface. This container is responsible for instantiating, assembling, managing, and storing the components of our application. Then, through dependency injection, the Spring container ensures that each component being instantiated receives its required dependencies, which are basically components themselves. In Spring Boot, this is reflected by using annotations such as @AutoWired or @Component, which allow developers to declare and inject dependencies seamlessly. Now, in Spring, a component that is instantiated, assembled, and managed by the Spring container is referred to as a bean. Beans are the backbone of a Spring application. They represent the various components and services that comprise the application's architecture. These components can range from simple plain old Java objects or POJOs to complex business logic classes. And as previously mentioned, the Spring container is responsible for managing these beans. It provides a runtime environment for beans to interact with each other, facilitating dependency injection, aspect-oriented programming, and other key features of the Spring framework. The Spring container operates in two primary modes, the BeanFactory and the application context. The BeanFactory is the central interface for accessing and managing beans within a Spring application. It provides basic bean instantiation and dependency resolution capabilities. On the other hand, application context extends the functionality of the BeanFactory, offering additional features such as event propagation, internationalization support, and integration with other Spring modules. In Spring Boot, beans can be declared and configured using various mechanisms, including XML-based configuration, Java-based configuration, and annotation-based configuration. The most common approach is the annotation-based one, where beans are annotated with Spring stereotypes such as @Component, @Service, @Repository, or @Controller to indicate their roles within the application. Additionally, beans can be wired together using dependency injection, where the dependency bean is injected into the dependent bean through constructor injection, setter injection, or field injection. To see this in action, we can bring back the Spring Boot application we've been implementing throughout this series and open any class, literally. From the controller down to the repositories, we've consistently utilized Spring Boot stereotype annotations, all of which extend the @Component annotation. And if we zoom in on any of these components, we will notice the use of Lombox required args constructor, which basically allows us to make use of the constructor injection to provide these components with their dependencies. This could have also been achieved by making use of the @AutoWired annotation provided by Spring, as we can see in front of us. Also, we made use of the @Qualifier annotation to pick which specific repository implementation we want to inject into our service. Okay, if we attempt to run this application, we will see a bunch of text quickly appearing before printing out the famous listening to port 8080. Now, let's zoom in on this text. Notice how before starting the app, the application context is being initialized and other crucial components needed by our application? These components represent the core elements provided by the Spring framework. They form the foundation of the Spring ecosystem and are crucial for building Spring Boot Java applications. So, to sum up, inversion of control is the principle of relinquishing control of our application's components to an external entity. And dependency injection is the programming technique that helps us manage the dependencies between these components. Together, IoC and DI form the bedrock of modern software development practices, enabling developers to build modular, maintainable, and scalable applications with ease. In Spring Boot's case, Beans and the Spring Container embody these principles, allowing developers to streamline application development, improve code quality, and enhance their overall productivity. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.